Hey all, I'm John Avlon, and this is Reality Check on the Extremist Beat. We're all living on the front lines of a war on truth. Disinformation threatens to distort every aspect of our civic debates, undercutting our sense of common facts and common ground. But while disinformation has proliferated via the internet and social media, its core playbook has been used in analog form dating back decades, spreading conspiracy theories while inflaming domestic divisions. We need to be aware of this hidden history, of these active measures, to restore a sense of perspective and confidence in our democracy's ability to combat disinformation. Let's take a deeper look at how the KGB under the old Soviet Union created many of these techniques, and you'll quickly see how they echo on today. Listen to this 1983 CNN report on Soviet disinformation.
Soviet defectors confirm that so-called active measures to discredit the United States are carried out by Soviet agents working out of embassies in Washington and other world capitals, working with friendly publications willing to accept falsified documents without checking them.
American officials say the effect of the publication of Soviet forgeries is hard to counter. It's hard to retract the impact of a forgery once the damage has been done.
These efforts were extensive, occasionally absurd, but relentless, occupying as much as a quarter of the KGB's time and billions of dollars, encompassing everything from baseless accusations that the CIA killed JFK to aggravating racial divisions and infiltrating Green parties and anti-war protests. Operation Infection is an iconic example, the KGB pushing a false story about America creating AIDS in a lab, getting it published in an obscure English language newspaper in India called The Patriot, which was then picked up and repeated, effectively laundered, until in this case, it made its way onto the CBS Evening News a few years later. The playbook is clear and time-tested. Exploit divisions in society to decrease trust. Push a big lie through third parties and useful dupes. And when called out on it, deny everything. As we now know, these efforts did not disappear after the fall of the Soviet Union, especially when a former KGB officer named Vladimir Putin took control of the country. And he recognized faster than many that the rise of the internet and social media provided a means of disseminating disinformation faster and more extensively than ever before. And don't take my word for it. Listen to a former Soviet agent.
In those days, you know, it was pretty hard to disseminate this kind of information. Nowadays, it's so much easier. You know, social media makes it possible.
The 2016 election was in some ways a culmination of that KGB training, not only interfering in the election on behalf of the Trump campaign, as a Republican-led Senate Intelligence Committee report detailed, but an extensive effort to turn fellow Americans against one another. Now, perhaps the most iconic example of this was seen in one infamous incident where the Russian Internet Research Agency used Facebook to create two competing rallies on opposite sides of the same street in Houston. On one side were American flags and Confederate flags in protest of what was billed as the Islamicization of Texas, while counter-protesters had signs calling the other side Nazis while defending the local Islamic center. The rallies were real, but the people participating didn't realize that they'd been duped by Russian trolls seeking to divide our nation. In some ways, it's the perfect metaphor for the dangers of disinformation, a fear-fueled feedback loop between activists who may be easily manipulated by foreign adversaries who understand that polarization is America's Achilles heel. When we come back, we'll be joined by Professor Thomas Ridd, author of the book Active Measures, The Secret History of Disinformation and Political Warfare, and CNN's Donie O'Sullivan, whose disinformation reporting on the extremist beat found a suspicious Black Lives Matter group with its true origins 4,000 miles away.
I know that there is no organization called Don't Shoot, and so I knew that something was off.
The U.S. image abroad is damaged, and U.S. foreign policy is complicated by disinformation. The primary origin of disinformation about the United States abroad is the Soviet Union.
Thomas, it's clear that there is a through line, a direct connection between the societal divisions that the Soviets tried to exacerbate during the Cold War and its online efforts today. I was really struck by one story in your book is the Soviet efforts or actions in spray painting swastikas outside synagogues in West Germany.
Yeah, this was a truly remarkable operation by, again, by KGB and partner agencies, where they understood that there was a real trauma, a real social division in West Germany. Remember, this is only about a little more than a decade after the Holocaust. So clearly anti-Semitism was a real problem in Germany still. So they understood that they could take forgeries, in this case fake swastikas, and inject them into that real division, into that real conversation that's going on in West Germany, and then pry open divisions and really exacerbate problems.
Some 40,000 Berliners rally before a memorial to the victims of Hitlerism to denounce West Germany's small but increasingly active neo-Nazi movement.
They called it enhanced contradictions in the target society itself.
Enhanced contradictions. Donie, as an extension of that idea, you've done a lot of excellent reporting on Russian efforts to co-opt groups like Black Lives Matter. What did you find?
Yeah, so in 2017, as all of this was coming to light of how Russia had used social media to try and mess around with the election and American society, Facebook began taking down pages. And they took down a huge Black Lives Matter page, hundreds of thousands of followers, called Don't Shoot. I realized this page isn't just posting here. It's actually actively promoting and organizing events. And I found one event that happened in Minneapolis right after the shooting of Philando Castile in 2016. And I went back and I spoke to some of the organizers, some activists on the ground who realized there was something a little off with this event. Have I watched?
We got an anonymous tip forwarded to us that stated that their website was registered to some strip mall in Illinois.
But no one at the mall knew about the website. It was a fake address, it was a fake page, it was a fake website. In reality, Don't Shoot was being run from more than 4,000 miles away in St. Petersburg, Russia.
They weren't just targeting Black Lives Matter. I mean, we saw this over and over again, a lot of pro-Trump Facebook pages leading to real world events. In one crazy instance, they sent money, co-opted an unwitting American and sent them money to build a cage for a anti-Hillary Clinton lock her up event.
Think about this for a moment. If you're going in and you're exacerbating existing tensions, like anti-Semitism in West Germany in the 1960s, or indeed the political divisions in the United States today, you're only really affecting something, possibly affecting something that is already happening. So it creates a measurement problem for you if you're the person or the organization running this. How do you know whether you caused something or whether something was organically happening already?
You know, part of the genius of this disinformation campaigns, right, is it almost makes us afraid of our own shadow. And one thing that I pointed out in a report years ago when we figured out that this major page on Facebook with about 500,000 followers was actually run from Russia, a fake Black Lives Matter page, was I had noticed as we had downloaded all the posts that people behind the page were consistently using the wrong sort of apostrophe.
Like here, where they use a backwards apostrophe. It turns out a lot of Russian keywords don't have the standard apostrophe that's used in the English language.
For years after that, I was getting constantly sent accounts, who sort of hyper-political accounts, people would flag them to me and say, this account's using the wrong sort of apostrophe and it's pro-Trump or it's anti-Trump. And I would look at it and I'd be like, it's a real person, a real American. It's not part of a Russian disinformation campaign. But I think it does point to so much of how all of this instills fear. Even we cover this because it's important to cover if you have a foreign nation targeting your country like this. But even in the coverage of it, again, we're almost playing into it. It's an impossible situation we're in, and it's the genius of these campaigns.
All right, Thomas, when we come back, the history of disinformation really contains a lot of warnings about the future. And I want to talk to you about how disinformation is designed to decrease trust and how that's particularly damaging for democracies.
U.S. officials have uncovered some 6 incidents of alleged Soviet forgeries around the world. Although the State Department does not consider the campaign especially threatening, it has begun publicly exposing the forgeries, believing that disinformation is best countered with information rather than secrecy.
Judging from the past, what's worked best in combating disinformation, and what hasn't?
In the past, just exposing the disinformation operation, the active measures, has worked fairly well. And it's a quaint thing to say that, you know, we have to let the facts speak for themselves, but actually it does still work with a significant audience. They do trust proper sourcing and the facts when you report them out correctly. I truly believe that. But there's a new dynamic, and I just want to point out the attention economy has changed. There are major media personalities in this country who sit down before they, you know, when they make a show and produce it, and really think about how can I generate the maximum amount of outrage. Think of them as leeches. They suck onto your, you know, skin by generating outrage, and then your attention is the blood that makes them grow bigger. If you respond to tweets or respond to a specific show that is so outrageous, then you're actually participating in what they're trying to achieve. But of course, if there's a powerful conspiracy narrative out there that influences a lot of people, we have to counter it, and we have to, but we have to counter it in a way that that isn't, if you like, arrogant. We can't just simply say these are the facts and you got it wrong.
I've told quite a few people that, you know, the thing that they got involved in online, the thing that they were being sent money for from an anonymous source to run a rally, was actually coming from Russia. And some people are mortified, but some people aren't. One person I met who is very much on the far left, and was involved in running a rally in Union Square here in New York City. It turned out the Russians had sent her a megaphone, a physical megaphone, to her home in Long Island. She didn't care when I told her that it was Russian.
But my big interest is getting the message out that we need Medicare for all. And I'm willing to ally with different people to do that.
Is that a person just being stubborn and sort of putting on a brave face? Maybe. And that is maybe where we have to allow a person to do that. But I don't think every American necessarily is concerned. I think we've got to a point in this country that people are so polarized and entrenched on their side, they don't care who's helping them.
Donie, what else do you see as a potential solution?
My area of focus a lot is on social media. And I think there is a lot to be said for not just what content is on the platforms, but I think more conversation about how pieces of content is getting surfaced into people's feeds, right? That being said, I think there's probably, and this is coming from the CNN social media reporter, too much of an emphasis on the role of social media has to play on all of this. You know, there's so many cracks and divisions. You know, we got to start thinking about this as a problem and an issue, not that we're going to face for the next year or two. I think this is going to be one of the defining issues that we face in this century of how do we deal with this.
Quick question to Donie, because I'm so curious. I sometimes walk away from these conversations, from conversations like this one, with a degree of, with a bit, like, it's a bit sad and depressing that we just stare the problem in the face, but don't really have good solutions. Does that sometimes pull you down, doing this kind of reporting?
Sometimes, and that's why I find the question about solutions so difficult, because, again, I really don't see a way out of this at the moment. That's very pessimistic. And that is sort of why I talk about this as a decades-long problem, a sort of a century-defining problem, because, you know, I sort of hope one day that by continuing to cover this, I'll be able to say, well, here are some solid solutions. But right now, it seems like we're so far down that rabbit hole, it's scary.
There's no silver bullet here. And we're dealing with new problems. I do think we spend a lot of time, even in journalism, focusing on diagnosing the problem and not enough pivoting towards solutions. You know, social media adjusting algorithms so they don't reward people going down confirmation bias rabbit holes is incredibly important. That's a problem we can solve through regulation and transparency and data. We can start insisting on civic education again that we've cut the hell out of. So, for example, students in American high schools have to pass the same citizenship and naturalization exam that new immigrants do to ensure a baseline knowledge of democracy, as well as an awareness of non-democratic countries and what's gone wrong. We can adjust the incentive structures in our politics so politicians are no longer rewarded for playing to the extremes in the base of their parties through closed partisan primaries and the rigged system of redistricting and the end of competitive general election districts. You know, these problems are cultural, they are political, they are economic, they are technological. But by chipping away at them and thinking about it more holistically, I think we can and we should move towards solutions rather than simply getting ourselves in a despairing spiral about how democracies and open societies will always be at a disadvantage from their authoritarian competitors.
You make some great points there. Absolutely.
I think that's good. You've got better solutions than I. And I think, as you say, the algorithm, and so people look at this and say, why am I seeing this?
What I think, Thomas, your writing and Donie, your reporting shows us is that sunlight remains the best disinfectant and that we need to push back on this without amplifying the disinformation ourselves. It's a difficult line to walk, but it's essential for a civil society. I want to thank you both for a great conversation and for your work. Be well.
Thank you.